never know if it could change your life. Take a chance, you're neither wrong or right. You never know if you don't roll them dice. You better roll them dice. You never know if it could change your life. One, two. Take a chance, you're neither wrong or right.
By the way, it's a great transition into our topic for today, which is Critical Role.
Oh my God, Critical Role.
Oh my God,
it's so good.
It is very good. It is very good. And we'll come to the homebrew part of it in a little bit. But for those who are not aware, which is probably not that many people if you're listening to a Dungeons & Dragons podcast, but Critical Role is a actual play, mostly Twitch stream, but also it's on YouTube and now it's a podcast, but an actual play run by Matthew Mercer of Overwatch fame.
It's high noon.
With several of his friends, all of them voice actors, and they have been recording and playing this D&D game for... it is wildly popular. Matt and I were discussing before we started the podcast that it, you know, the launch of the second season of Critical Role had 135,000 Twitch viewers, which is, I think, like, a lot for Twitch. Maybe not compared to like PUBG or something, but again, in this niche, it's a lot.
And, they're no Dr. Disrespect.
They're no Dr. Disrespect. And they're definitely no...
They're not some weird mustachio guy who cheated on his wife. I don't know what's going on there,
back.
But that's getting
he's
off
back.
Topic.
Yeah, but it's no Logan Paul, but it... yeah.
It's no Logan Paul. They haven't gone to Japan yet and filmed themselves with a
but
dead body.
It is very popular, and it's such like a niche thing. So Matt and I... we're very slow to get on the actual play train. We, even as longtime players and DMs, did not traditionally enjoy watching other people play Dungeons & Dragons. And it's still like not my favorite way to consume the content, but I have to admit that Critical Role has really grown on me. It is entertaining to watch.
If you watch Critical Role and enjoy it, that's good because it's a great show. But Rob and I will argue that nothing can truly beat the pleasure or the joy that comes from playing in your own game or running your own RPG. So we're hoping that if you stumbled upon this podcast because you're a fan of Critical Role and maybe you've played Dungeons & Dragons once or twice before, or you're really interested in playing because you love this show, this episode will help get you started in making that transition from being a watcher of Dungeons & Dragons to being a player.
Yeah, and that's...
there are two kinds of people in this world.
Two kinds of people.
There are watchers and there are players.
Our position has always been that what's great about Critical Role is that it gets new players interested in Dungeons & Dragons and involved in the game. And we hope... obviously, if you just want to watch, you should, and it's great. But I think my hope is, and probably Matt Mercer's hope, is that you'll watch it and then be inspired to play your own game. And that's, I think, the very cool thing about it. It's such a great, even for me, a very, like, and Matt, you know, experienced DMs, it's such a great way to get ideas and to learn and to, you know, steal things that we like that Matt Mercer does. But,
Whether you're experienced or new, there's stuff you can take from this show, and we're going to try and break some of that down for you.
Yeah, we wanted to talk about what you can learn.
Specifically from this new season.
Yeah, because Matt and I have not watched all of the last season, but we have watched almost all. I think we're mostly caught up on the new season, and we wanted to talk about that and talk about what you can learn, what's good and what's bad, because it's not all... you know, not all things you're going to be able to use in your own game. But let's talk about what Matt Mercer is good at.
So Matt Mercer is... his strength as a DM is, first of all, he's a beautiful, beautiful man.
Very handsome man.
He looks
easy
like,
on the eyes.
I think,
it's important.
What every nerdy hetero guy like kind of wants to look like, yeah. Right? His long hair is neither stringy nor in a ponytail. He can pull off a motorcycle jacket.
Yeah.
He's just beautiful. And he uses that charisma and beauty in a great way to really sell the action that's happening. And Matt Mercer's a professional voice actor with, you know, dozens of years of experience working on all kinds of things. So he can do the voices of almost anything. In the first couple episodes, he goes from, you know, a little child to an old man to some gruff guards to monsters, mm-hmm. and he does them all, and he sells them, and his players love it.
You don't have to be beautiful to be a DM. That's mostly a joke, though it helps. But what he does have, and one thing that you should try to work on is presence, right? You're trying to sell your vision and your story to your players, and a lot of that has to do with how you're able to present the story. And so having I guess a stage presence, having a, you know, being able to command the attention of the room the way that Matt Mercer does is very, very powerful, and it will help your players get engaged with the story that you're telling and the world that you're trying to build.
And talking about Matt Mercer's voice and presence, he's very good at two things that all people who want to run a Dungeons & Dragons game should try and master, which is, one, knowing that line on too much description and DM voice versus not enough, right?
Right.
Getting that essentialness of whatever scene is happening in this play, this theater of the mind, describing it so that the players have something to go off of, but not talking for long enough that they get bored, distracted, or you steal their time from them.
Yeah, that's exactly right. So Matt Mercer is a very experienced DM, and as Matt has pointed out, he does have a lot of excellent descriptions and exposition, but he times exactly right. And if you are trying to watch Critical Role to become a better Dungeon Master, really pay attention to how long it takes Matt Mercer to deliver a description or to give exposition at the start of an event or the beginning of a session, because Matt's absolutely right, he gives just enough to set the scene and engage the players, and then he lets them loose.
And it's
very, very skilled. He's really good at getting the timing exactly right on this.
And this is what's great about his descriptions, is he gives enough and then the description becomes a dialogue, right? Mm-hmm. He describes the scene. There's three things. Player says, I look at this thing, or I go over and touch this, and then he can give more, right? It becomes interactive, mm-hmm. instead of and if you're someone who's starting their first adventure by buying a pre-canned module or something like that, there's these things called kind of block description text. Mm-hmm. And players really tune out when you read a paragraph or three paragraphs that describe a room or a village, mm-hmm. or something like that. If you keep it short and to the point and then let players enter into a dialogue with you, then it becomes much more interesting.
I do want to go back and mention something. So this is something that I've encountered on the online, on forums and elsewhere, is Matt Mercer is so good at voices that some players and DMs feel like that is something that you have to be able to do to be a good Dungeon Master. And that's absolutely not true. You do not have to be able to do any voice besides your own to be a good Dungeon Master. That's just when
you don't have to do any voice about your own.
Matt and I can both do some voices, and I enjoy it, and I'm proud of my, you know, the few accents that I can do. But it's just window dressing. And it doesn't really... It shouldn't really impact the game. And that's not why his games are so great, though. It is one of the reasons why they're so great to watch.
Right. And the thing about your games is you're never going to get, I'm sorry, a million followers to watch you and your friends play Dungeons & Dragons. What you will be able to get is some fun with your friends. But the thing about voice acting is that you don't actually have to be good at it, right? You can try it. But you don't have to be a professional voice acting to have that add something to your players. Just the act of trying adds some color to an NPC. And it doesn't have to be, you know, if you have an evil emperor or general come into your story and you're like, ah, well, this person should be British to give that air of aristocracy and superiority. You don't actually have to be good at a British accent for it to add something to your players. And then the other thing about voice acting is it doesn't actually have to be an accent. It could be an attitude or a posture that you as a player or a DM assume, right? If I'm playing an old decrepit zombie or a lich or an old man, right, I might sort of hunch myself over and speak very softly or something like that. Or if I'm an excitable child, I might get her up and move around the table.
Matt makes a great point here. One of the players does a really good job of this specifically. I think it's Marisha Ray, the player who plays Bo. So Bo doesn't have an accent. She just has sort of a way of talking, sort of a gruff and, you know, laconic kind of, you know, thing. And it really works, but there's no accent there. So it's definitely think about if you can't do an accent, and not everybody can. And also, even if you can do accents, even Matt Mercer only has like a half dozen that he can pull out. And sooner or later, your players are going to notice that every bad guy is British, or every innkeeper is a Scotsman.
Or every druid sounds like a redneck.
Exactly.
But yeah, her character is Beauregard, right? Is a great example is that she doesn't do a voice, but she does a posture. And I'm like, I know this type of person, right? Mm-hmm. They're that asshole employee at REI.
this is very specific.
There's someone they're like someone I met at a national park who's like an asshole park ranger is what she sounds like.
Yeah, it's great. So when you're thinking about so one of the things that's great to learn from this is thinking about ways to texture and add variety and depth to your players and your campaign. And it's such great examples of how you can do a voice or adopt an attitude to play different NPCs, again, even if you're not a deeply experienced voice actor.
But if you do want to, I would just say one last thing about voice acting is if you do want to give your character that sort of specific voice, or as a DM, have a couple of voices up your sleeve, it's not hard to learn. Mm-hmm. There are videos on YouTube by voice coaches and things, and you just have to learn a couple oral postures, right? And so if you want to be a Texan, you can kind of pull those cheeks back tight, and you can talk about tumbleweeds and choose your vocabulary in a way that talks about rustling and heads of cattle, big hats. Or, you know, you can move that tongue forward to give yourself a spicy accent. Then you talk about the gabagool.
Then
you've got a gangster.
Yeah.
Hey, gabagool.
Gabagool. Yeah. Please do not, please ignore Matt's anti-Italian racism. How dare you?
Listen, I'm not saying that all Italians are criminals. I'm saying that all Southern Italians are criminals.
Right, no, yeah.
Right? If you live south of Rome...
Dirty Sicilians can't be trusted. So what else does Matt Mercer do well? Because obviously the strength of the podcast and the reason why, or the show and why it's so good to watch, has a lot to do with him being a voice actor. But he's also a great DM.
Yeah, and I want to say here's a trick that every DM should use. And when I saw Matt Mercer doing it, I patted myself on the back and said, "Oh, Matt, you're wonderful." Do this several times a day. But one of the things he says is seems to be and looks to be. And it's kind of a verbal tick.
Yeah.
And maybe it's kind of annoying, but it's actually a really great way to approach talking about the world, right? Because you never want to – you always want to leave that bit of mystery for your players that this is what it is based on your perception. So if they pick up – a fancy thing. It's like, ooh, it seems to be made of an expensive metal, right? Mm. And later on, they can find out whether that's true. Or, you know, this character looks to be some kind of magic user. You know,
yeah, absolutely.
Confirming or denying anything, and that's a fun way to run your descriptions of the world.
Yeah, it's a great way to sow doubt and to also add some uncertainty, especially with things that they should perhaps not be entirely certain about, like, you know, magical objects or unknown NPCs, you know, appears to be a human, you know, this sword seems to be magical, you know, it's just a good way to, yeah, Mercer does that a lot, especially about things that he wants the players to look more closely at. It's a good way to suggest to them that they should invest more time and or energy. I think one of the things that I think that Matt does very well is that I guess this is his job, but he is eminently prepared. You'll see him when the players will ask him things that he's not prepared for. They'll ask him the names of NPCs who should not have names, or, you know, about shops in town that there's absolutely no reason anybody would want to go to, but they want to go to those shops. And he has a binder, and he'll flip through his binder and he'll find his list of names, or he'll find the list of the shops. And this is just like such a great object lesson for DMs, is that you should just have a list of names, right? And just a general idea of what's in the area, even if you think it might never come up.
Right. And it can be Googling popular baby names, right, from the 1930s, yeah, right? Yeah. You don't have to come up with this shit yourself.
Exactly. The flip side is that you don't want to fall prey to over preparation. You don't actually need to, you know, find out what every single building in town is, but, you know, this is just like such a great lesson in how to prepare, just having enough of the right types of information so that when your players inevitably ask you for something that you're not expecting them to ask about, that you have an answer.
Absolutely. And getting to the mechanics of the game, because role-playing games have skills and checks, and if you watch the show, you notice this, it's not all freeform, and Matt Mercer is a master of this, in that he tightly controls in his beautiful manly hands the ability of when players get to make a roll.
Yep.
The dungeon master always decides when a player needs to roll a dice or make a check, and Matt Mercer does this so well that players feel excited and rewarded when they get to do something that causes them to roll a d20 and that there could be success or failure.
Yeah.
What I see a lot in less good actual plays and in my other games that I've been in is that players will steal this ability, the decision of when a roll is made, from the dungeon master. And eventually the wanna do it, right? Players will constantly say, I'll make a perception check, or I make a stealth check, right? But over time, they will become less happy if you let them take that. So this is for their own good. When the player's job is to describe their actions, and the players in this game do that very well, and the dungeon master says, now is the time when, if a player says, I'm sneaking out of the tavern, right? The dungeon master might just say, okay, you do so. The dungeon master sometimes will say, but now you need to make a stealth check, and then ups the tension.
Mm-hmm. And it's so true. His players, who are very experienced, still get very excited every time that they make a roll, because Matt does such a good job of, I guess, let's call it rationing those roles.
Ration it. Yes.
Every time that you make in the critical role campaign in one of Matt Mercer's games, your role is significant. And sometimes they do a lot of rolling. In the most recent, or the second most recent episode, they had to make a ton of stealth checks because they're trying to sneak around in the middle of the night and not get caught by the guards. And the tension was very high every time they had to make those, because, you know, the stakes were high. And what Matt Mercer does is he and this is the thing that I am personally guilty of, but he doesn't fudge. If you roll a four, there are consequences. You know, if you botch your check, then something bad happens. It's not always like a huge deal, but he really does. So he does a really good job of adhering to the rules in a way that is fair and challenging. I guess this is right. I think what Matt's point is, and what a lot of people can learn, is that it is up to the DM to decide how the rules of the game function.
If your player says they do something, a lot of times it's okay to just say, yes, you do that, right? Mm-hmm. It helps the game go faster. Or you can just say, no, that's probably impossible, right? But you get to decide when it's that chance for them to use those mechanics and when they come into play. Control the rules, ration the rules.
That's exactly right. Yeah, so like I said, I'm guilty of softening the blow when my players fail or don't quite meet the DC just to keep things going. But if you can make it work, this is, again, an issue of preparation and of Matt Mercer tightly controlling when rules are made, then, you know, the rules function extremely well.
Well, these two things are connected, Rob.
Yes. Yeah.
Is never fudging the rolls, which is an option you have as the DM, right? You can make all the NPC rolls out on the table. Mm-hmm. You can, you know, never say, I like to do something where, like, if players are making a roll, I'll tell them before they make the roll, okay, this is a, you need a 10 to succeed on this. Mm-hmm. You need a 15, right?
Yeah.
So they know that I am not going to fudge, right?
Right.
If you are going to fudge, you don't have to tell them the thing. But the two things come hand in hand. When you parcel out when they get to make a roll, then you don't have to fudge, right? Because if you have a thing where, you know, the players are trying to bribe a guard, right? And you don't want them to fail. You want them to succeed, right?
Mm-hmm.
Then if you just say, oh, yeah, this guard wants to be bribed, you don't have to make a roll. He's already friendly to you. Then if you called for them to make a persuasion check and they rolled a 2 and their result is only a 6 and you say, well, it succeeds anyways. Well, then the players know that that roll probably wasn't that important or that you were going to fudge it anyway. So why not just skip the roll?
Exactly right.
Not fudging.
What lessons maybe you should not draw from critical roll.
Right. And the most important thing and a caveat for everyone watching this game and trying to draw inspiration is that Critical Role is both a show and a game.
Right.
It's a show for the audience is the spectator for you. And of course, you know, the players, you have fun when the players have fun, but your game is not a show. You don't have to please anyone but the people sitting around the table. Your players are not professional actors. Your DM or you're not getting paid to do this. So
probably
you can't expect the same types of results.
And we have seen this some, again, on the online, people being disappointed or people expecting critical role level campaigns from amateur or not, you know, experienced DMs. And that's, I don't think that's a huge problem. I don't think it's all that widespread, but it is something to watch out for. Definitely, even if you did have a whole group of voice actors and professionals, it wouldn't be the same game as the one that Matt Mercer is running. And
you can't expect your players, like drawing from this first season, you can't expect your players to spend 3 hours just getting to know one another and keeping it entertaining. And they're probably not going to want to do that because they're not professional improvers or voice actors.
Right.
They're going to want something to happen.
So that actually brings me to one of the things that I don't love about the way that Matt Mercer DMs. And this is a personal pet peeve, I think. And maybe it really depends on who you are and what kind of game you are. But he gives... He gives his players too much leeway. If they want to spend 3 hours dicking around like they did in the second episode of this season, then he lets them do that. And I tend to give them... If my players are wasting time or, you know, spending a bunch of energy and doing a lot of nonsense stuff that is tangential to the campaign when there's, you know, progress to be made, I tend to give them a nudge. Either... in the form of a hint or an NPC or some sort of event that occurs near them to get them back on track. I don't know if Matt agrees, but there were long stretches in the last few episodes of Critical Role that weren't boring because it's funny, it's entertaining to watch all of those people do anything, but where nothing was really happening and it didn't necessarily have to be that way.
Yeah, it doesn't. I think... This is part of something, and I'll put a link to this article from the great blog, the Alexandrian, .net, is that if you want players to move in a particular direction, or like after the first episode, there's a mystery, what caused this like undead attack? Why did this circus go off the rails? You need to give your players a bunch of clues. The three clue rule,
yeah.
Right? And the players, you know, sort of thought there was this mystery that they needed to investigate. They either were not seeing the clues that Matt put in front of them, or there weren't enough, right? They went all around town looking for things when the answer was right back at the carnival. Remembering this right?
Yeah, you're remembering right. They
and there should have been there should have been several clues, right? A guard should have said, "Whatever you do, the carnival's off limits." They should have picked up something at the scene of the crime that pointed to this. I had this happen in my own game, right? I put four clues in of a place that players could go to further the plot. They never found one, right? They ignored another one. And then they finally had two of them. And then the two were enough to say, oh, here's a connection here.
The Curse of Strahd game that I'm running is actually a great example of this, because the module explicitly doesn't tell, there's no real direction. It's like one big sandbox, but you're given three MacGuffins to go after and a bunch of plot threads, and there's one very obvious big bad that you need to take on. And
his name is Curse.
His name's Curse, not Strahd. And if
it's a common misconception.
Yeah, if your players aren't experienced, and mine are, and they totally got what they were supposed to do right away, but it can feel sort of, they can be crippled by indecision, I guess, and or by too many choices. So it was fun to watch, and if you're, there is a certain something to be said for letting your players fail or letting them explore those threads. But I don't know. Most of us don't have, you know, most of us have limited gaming time, I guess. You know, we're all adults and it's difficult to get people together. And
right, so, we're not getting paid for every session.
Exactly. No, so I don't like to let my players be lost for too long. I also, this is, a personal pet peeve. I hate shopping time. I don't tend to role play out shop encounters. I try to, unless it's an important one, or if it's, you know, they're doing something non-standard, but I try to just gloss over those as fast as possible to get to something that's not transactional. This is, so as Matt has been pointing out, this is because they're getting paid and this is their job. If they want to spend hours and hours wandering aimlessly or investigating red herrings, then that's no big deal. But for most of us, we do this for fun. And I don't know a single DM whose primary concern is not scheduling and trying to get everybody together as often as possible. So with limited gaming time, you want to try to do what you can to keep your players moving without railroading them.
And it doesn't mean like if there's a thing you want players to discover and then they go after a red herring, you don't have to devote an hour of gaming time, right? Because remember, you ration when players make rolls and when they get to make checks. And if the players say, we're going to camp all night to try and find the person who's sneaking into the village, you say, all right, you camp all night. You keep a careful watch. If anyone was coming by, you almost certainly would have noticed them. No one comes by.
Right.
And then, boom, you're done. You show them that this red herring is a red herring, at least for now.
And sometimes your players may be disappointed by that. They may not like that their, you know, their clever idea turned out to be a nothing burger. But, you know, it keeps the game moving. It makes sure that there's, you know, not every moment needs to be action, but there should be something interesting happening, speaking to NPCs or finding clues or developing characters. And so this is one thing that I think that players should absolutely not take away from Critical Role is the way that the sessions tend to, especially these first early ones, tend to linger. It was very entertaining to watch the players, like Matt said, get to know each other over the course of, you know, 1 or 2 hours. But that's way too long. Most of your players are absolutely not going to want to do that or be able to do that. Personally, I think that it's better to have their PCs get to know each other in an active way in the course of adventuring. We talked about this in our session zero, session one conversation, but I tend to like to throw my players into the action right away to sort of,
right,
like a crucible, get them to know each other in the fire of battle.
Absolutely. Another thing that maybe you should take or not try and take away from Critical Role is that, you know, I think this is a lesson for everyone, especially DMs. If you do a lot of world building and dump on them a lot of history and backstory, players will probably not learn and ignore most of it and make fun of the rest. That's okay.
That's okay.
If you're a dungeon master, you should be prepared and enjoy your players mocking of your world building, right? Mm-hmm. They'll appreciate it. They'll only appreciate world building and backstory in the way that it affects them and their character, at least at first.
That makes me think of one other thing, and this isn't necessarily like a criticism, but it is. I want to give a warning, because Matt Mercer has, in both of his campaigns, had a player start the campaign with one of his homebrew classes, or a homebrew version of his classes. And while that's not wrong per se, it's a little bit like taking like an a test plane, you know, on a cross country journey. It's extremely risky, and it may not, if you do this in one of your home games and you're not careful about the class that you're creating or the race or the option, then you may end up giving one player special treatment or extra powers that the other players will find frustrating or come to resent.
Right. The important thing is that you tell that player, right, this is a homebrew class. I reserve the right, in consultation with you, but not with your veto approval, to change how this class works so that everyone can continue to have fun.
Yeah. And we'll hopefully do a maybe a short session on the Blood Rager itself.
Blood Hunter.
Whether it's good or bad.
I'll say that in the Nathan Explosion voice.
Blood Hunter. So that's a thing that he does, and he's an experienced DM, and I'm mostly okay with his. I mostly like his homebrew stuff, but it is extremely risky, and it's. I have heard dozens and dozens of examples of DMs putting in their own, you know, pet class or pet race, and having a player pick that and having it be overpowered or underpowered or special snowflakey, and it is just something that you really want to look out for, especially if you're homebrewing your own stuff.
Is that maybe you're watching a Critical Role and you have a chance to be a player for the first time or improve your game as a player? The show is not just for DMs, so I want to talk about the players in this game and some of the great things and maybe things you want to avoid that they do. I think the first and biggest one is that all the players at the table have what I like to call a generosity of play. They are there to laugh at everyone's jokes, to praise their successes, and to empathize with their failures. And if you do that as a player, other players will love you for that, right? It's all part of a group. You're all here to have fun. So come into play with a generosity of spirit.
Right. And this is such a great example, and the players are very good about this, and it just means looking for opportunities to praise others, to highlight when their player characters can shine. You know, they'll often the Critical Role players will say, "Oh, Nott, you're good at that. Why don't you go, you know, sneak around and try to take that?" Or, "Oh, hey, Mollymock, you've got those fancy swords. Why don't you take care of this here?" Or, "Hey, Bo, you're strong. Why don't you, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera." And this is a great way to think about how to play. You want yourself to shine, your player character to shine, but you also want to give the rest of your team opportunities to show off what they're good at.
Yeah, and I think this leads into the second and connected thing, one of Robert's favorite points, is that you as a player should always be game to play.
Right.
You're coming here to play.
Right.
So they all have characters with backstories and outlooks and wants and needs, and they've really thought out how their players see the world, what they do when authorities showed up, what they want to buy when they go to a store. But throughout that, right, remember that you're a player and you make the decisions for your characters. And all of them can always come to the conclusion that I want to help the other players in the party and further what we want to all accomplish together. So they always decide to make the decision, oh, you know, we are kind of traveling alone and we want to stay low of the authorities. I could make the decision that The two of us, or the one of me, will go off into the wilderness to be safe. But I could also bind myself to this group, and they could help us out.
That's exactly right. And this
and
is
they
such,
always make that decision.
They always,
so always
make that
begin
choice. And it's great. And it's how you should be thinking. And this is such a great example from the first episode of this season. You know, Nott and Caleb are a pair, and they're loners, and they have their own grift that they're running. But then they run into these new people.
I love their fake grifts.
It's
like
a good grift. It's
the
a good
dragon's
grift.
Innards. Yeah. Should we run the Medusa's
yeah,
hair?
Shall we run the magic bowl? But yeah, they could easily say, oh, we don't want anything to do with these people. We're not wanted for questioning. Let's just split. But, you know, they'll say, oh, it's been great to have company. You know, maybe they can help us, you know, do our grifts better. You know, they look for reasons to want to be a part right. of the group. And I think that's so great. I think that is such a good thing to learn from the Critical Role cast. And it helps that they like each other in real life and that they have a rapport as a gaming crew. But the way that you build that is by looking for opportunities to highlight other players' characters and to want to be a part of the group. I think
right.
that's a great thing as a player to take away from Critical Role.
Whatever your character's outlook, you can always make the decision to be in the party. Let's say you want to make a character imagine you're joining the Critical Role campaign who hates goblins, right? You could say, well, my character would never adventure with a goblin. I'm racist against them for some reason. But you can also say, my character hates goblins. This goblin is up to no good. I'm going to make sure that I keep an eye on this goblin, right? I'm not going to let them know that I don't like them except in the most subtle way. But I'll adventure along on the goblin, and then later on, you can make the choice to not hate this one specific goblin, right?
Right.
You can, in character, find the reasons to be game, to play the actual game.
Yeah. It's exactly
and
right.
And they're great at that, and I love it. One other thing that I love about the players and that you as a player can take from this is, you know what every game needs more of is more lighthearted characters. Characters
right.
that are always ready to laugh at jokes that other players make, to tell them, oh, you're beautiful, you're awesome, you're wonderful. I think the
right.
player that does the jester character
oh, yeah.
does this really well. And it helps the game move along, and it's super fun, right? Lighthearted
you know,
characters to balance out the Batman.
This is a bit of a... Yeah, I know. can't have a team full of Batman or, you know, dark, haunted, vigilante types. The jester character, oh gosh, I forget her name, but it's such a great example, and this is a bit of a tangent, but she also does the, like, oh, wacky random thing, but she makes it
but
work.
Not too far.
But not too
yeah.
far. Exactly. She,
yes.
Exactly. If you have a player who wants to do the wacky random thing, say, look at Jester, take it maybe like 70% of that because you're not as good as she is, and that's fine, because it can be really annoying if you're not good at that, but she does a really good job of taking it just to the point of being funny obnoxious and not like actually obnoxious.
Right. Look at the time she does, that quirky thing, right? Oh, I'm going to, talk about drawing little sketches or makeup.
Right.
It's only a couple times an episode. She
yeah.
uses it sparingly, and therefore it's more impactful and fun.
Exactly. It is true. It actually, I think, is more challenging to play a lighthearted character or a fun, loving character than it is to play a grimdark one, just because of what's involved both in making the character and keeping up that energy. But if you're an experienced player or a new player and you want to bring something fun to the group or you want to challenge yourself, try being not, you know, a wacky, you know, weirdo or anything, but, you know, a fun, supportive, you know, lighthearted type character to support your crew.
The jester character, a great example of that. And the last thing, at least I took from the players in Critical Role, is, and this is the flip side of something we talked about earlier in Matt Mercer's DMing, is that the players hardly ever or almost never say, I make an arcana check.
Right.
I make a perception check. right? They always describe what their character is doing, right? Instead of saying, I make a perception check or an investigation check. Mm-hmm. I look over the spines of the book, touching them to see if any of them are old, or I think through what I know about zombies, right? Mm-hmm. And then Matt Mercer can say, well, you know this about zombies, or he can say, make a religion check.
Yeah, that's an excellent point.
Help your DM out by just describing your actions.
All right. So is there anything else in closing that we want to say about Critical Role? Matt and I are obviously big fans, and we're very happy that it's so popular. And it is such a great way to bring new players in, and it has got so much attention for Dungeons & Dragons. And it's such a good showcase for the game. It is, you know, it is really like an ideal example of what a great Dungeons and Dragons campaign can be like, and what I think is like really cool about it is the relationships and the cohesiveness and the rapport that the group has. I think that's the most, you know, the best thing about it that really demonstrates what's so great about D&D. Not the voices, not the actual campaign or anything right. like that, but the...
That's why people stay and watch the show. And yeah. If you have a successful game, that's why people will keep coming back.
That's exactly right. Hopefully this was of use to you. If you don't watch Critical Role, definitely give the new season a shot. It just started in early January, so there's only a few episodes. They're on the longer side for sure, but they've got a podcast. And yeah, just take a look, pay attention to what Matt Mercer does and what his players do, and think about how you can apply that to your own game.
Hell yeah. Go forth and crit some rolls.
Go forth and crit.
Deadeye's ready. It's high noon.
Cowboys ain't easy to love, and they're harder to hold. They'd rather give you a song than diamonds or gold.
Long star belt buckles and old faded Levi's, and each night begins a new day. If you don't understand him, he don't die young. He'll probably just ride away.
Mamas, don't let your babies grow up to be cowboys. Don't let them pick guitars or drive them old trucks. Let them be doctors and lawyers and such. Mamas, don't let your babies grow up to be cowboys. 'Cause they never stay home and they're always alone. Even with someone they love.